Okay, good. So, yeah, I'm happy to kick it off and to do an intro to cover partly, you know, the topic in hand, our business, and then hand over to San and then to Menzo. So thank you very much for joining us today. And what will no doubt be a really fascinating talk about data in the cloud for one of our trusted partners, Menzo. So thanks again, Menzo, for this. It's fantastic. And we're really looking forward to the content in front of us. So at Source Group International, we pride ourselves on four core technology pillars: cybersecurity, engineering, data, and cloud. Today, we will firmly be focusing on the data and cloud aspects. One of Source's core values is progression. We're constantly seeking ways to improve our service and to learn along the way. And I'm not sure if you heard us talking earlier, but I think we definitely feel we can we've all learned a thing or two this year, certainly about business as a whole, and certainly about data and technology. I'd like to use a quote from Craig Mundell, senior advisor to the CEO at Microsoft, who stated that data is becoming the new raw material of business. So with that in mind, we're keen to play our role with the data sharing of a new raw material of business and bring the data community together and share ideas and the vision for the way forward. So I'll now hand over to our data SGI subject matter expert, San.
Thank you. There are a lot of tech webinars out there on how to migrate to the cloud, but what happens with the team from a business perspective? Can you do a lift and shift, or do the personas change? That is what we will focus on today. Household message, this webinar will be recorded, so those who couldn't attend live, they can view it afterwards. And there will be time for questions after the presentation. If your question falls outside the scope, but still is related to cloud, just drop me an email and we'll arrange a separate call for you. And it gives me great pleasure to now give the virtual microphone to Menzo.
Well, thank you, Sanne. Welcome once again. And thanks to Source Technology to enable this. Basically, the bottom line of what we're discussing today is that everyone wants to innovate and no one wants to change. So what we're looking at are quite fundamental changes in going from an on-premise setup to a cloud setup in all its forms that can be done. And how do people react to that, or how do you get your people to do stuff in a new manner? My name is Menzo Steinhorst. I'm one of the co-founders of Data Fellows. Data Fellows is basically a cooperation of a couple of former Microsoft engineers. We all worked like 10 years for Microsoft. And we're a technical associate of Source Technology. That means we don't only do the regular, hourly based stuff for a recruiter, but we actively engage together in projects as well. I used to be a cloud solution architect at Microsoft from 2016 to 2018. And before that, I was a field engineer on data platform and the development platform at Microsoft. Let's dive right into that, because I have a couple of practical examples that I encountered in those years at Microsoft. Well, the objectives, why do we want to go to the cloud? What are the advantages, and why should we do it? And I go over those fairly quickly, because I think we all know why we want to do that. And what's the impact on your current team? What will happen when you do a step like that? But first, start with some tales from the trenches or part-time talk. With my experiences over the years in support cases, especially at Microsoft, at the field support, I had a suitcase down in the hallway standby, and we could be called upon any time at the day to travel to a customer with problems. And usually that meant a business down situation, a CFA in Microsoft terminology, or human life at danger. That was also one of the reasons that usually a hospital that experienced problems. One of the cases I want to go over is a travel and leisure e-commerce shop, which have a very predictable cycle. And that's either around Christmas, where they sell their holidays, or in June when the last minute season starts. Besides that, that website is fairly quiet. So not a lot of traffic. Let's say in August, when everybody returns from their holidays, they don't have any sales. It's a premium product. You pay premium prices for that. So people tend to go a couple of times to their site and book a holiday and basically never come back. So it's a very predictable cycle in which they are in. But every year around Christmas, their system collapses. They have huge performance issues, and they, well, basically that leads to lost business because they experience particular problems with handling the orders that are coming in. They do develop the system. It's a very peculiar system. They basically built their own ERP in SQL Server, which is not very common to do, but they never test. They don't load test. They don't do any other unit testing scenarios, which are quite hard to do in SQL Server anyway. So they don't know the ceiling either of their system, which leads to problems always. And they need to buy fairly expensive hardware and fairly beefy hardware to be able to handle those two peaks in a year. And this is a typical scenario where you want to go to the cloud because you don't need all that raw power except for those maybe 8 weeks a year or maybe even less. So in this case, a move to the cloud would have saved them literally hundreds of thousands of euros, well, only on licensing, let alone the hardware. Another one, this was one of the more spectacular ones. This was a large online retailer, and they thought of having a campaign around some major, well, some very popular brand clothing in January to have some extra revenue in their slow month of January when everybody has spent all their money at Christmas. And well, they came up with this action with very popular brands for very low prices. They started that on Sunday evening with an ad campaign on major television stations and social media campaign. And half an hour later, their site crashed and they experienced a complete shutdown of their site. Monday morning, I came in and, well, the retailer was in panic, of course, because it was completely down and they didn't have any revenue at all. Where in fact they were expecting some extra revenue for this action. The website shut down because of the excessive traffic, and they lost the backend connection to their ERP, which basically reported the stock levels back to the website. We spent roughly 2 weeks there. In the end, we came up with the idea to put 120 SQL Server boxes in parallel, which cost an awful lot of money to rent those hardware and to get it up and running, where one of those SQL boxes handling the read and write traffic, so basically storing the orders, and the rest of them were merely caches for the website. We had a complete rewrite of the front-end components because it was a nightmare how it was written, and it became fairly obvious that we couldn't do anything with it to get it up and running again. So we did that as well in 3 days and nights. And in the meantime, the Microsoft support team was extended to about 100 people. I was the only one on site because it was a company here in Holland. And I found myself in meetings with like 80 people who were completely panicking because of the loss of revenue. We did get it up and running again, sort of, but we never could fix the backend connection. That was a queue. And afterwards we calculated that the queue was like 6 weeks behind on reality. So although it worked more or less, they did sell a lot of items they didn't have in stock because the website was not aware of the current stock levels. And they had to disappoint a lot of customers, which led to a very long time of bad reputation. And for online retailer, that's possibly the worst case scenario, because it's very hard to get rid of something like that on social media. This one is probably the most expensive one I've been on. That was a major bank based in London. And they had branches all over the world, and most particularly in Hong Kong and New York. And they were experiencing latency. And what they actually wanted was a transaction that was done in Hong Kong that should be visible in any other branch within 300 milliseconds. That is top level. You don't get that for free. And you need some very specific network architecture to even be able to do that on such distances. What they measured was that at certain times, and they could correlate that to big worldwide events, their latency was over this 300 milliseconds and could be up to a second. And for me, just not working in financial industry as a financial expert, that posed not a problem, because a second from Hong Kong to New York shouldn't be that much of a deal, but for them it was. So they literally picked up the phone and called a marine contractor to order themselves their own dark fiber between London and New York. And we're talking about like half a billion euros or something in order to lay that cable across the ocean. In order to get that connection fixed to Hong Kong, they couldn't do that with a cable laid at sea, obviously. So they had to buy certain bandwidth between this station and across certain paths. So they wouldn't accept that data going through switches in Iran. It needed to go via Saudi Arabia to India, and they all had those pathways laid out. In the meantime, they ran an immensely complex peer-to-peer application, as we call it, to get their databases equal on all three branches. And again, this bank was anti-cloud at the moment. At the moment, they are in the cloud. And that would make their life so much easier, because they could have run a central database in the cloud somewhere, and they wouldn't have to do all these investments to get their latency up to this 300 millisecond. Just because it's basically their trade to support anti-fraud measures. But this was a very expensive one. And in the end, they used it for like 2 years. And after that, they moved to the cloud. The flavors of cloud we are looking at the moment. Starting with private cloud, which is basically the old data center structure that we used to have. So we have things like networking, storage, virtualization, the operating systems. You all did that yourself. On top of that, your business was running with the data and the applications that support your business. Excuse me. So the other four were basically necessities that you needed to take care of, but do not necessarily have anything to do with your business. The first, when cloud was introduced in, I believe Amazon came up with the cloud infrastructure as we know it today, around 2006, 2007, it was infrastructure as a service. And that's still a possibility at the moment. You can still use the cloud like this, but you use it more or less like a hosting provider. So the cloud provider takes care of networking, storage, and virtualization. And basically, you install a bunch of virtual machines on top of that and run your OSs, your data, and your applications on top of that. So you still have a lot of things that have nothing to do with your business, technical things, but you need to manage those in order to get it running. The next step was platform as a service, where you basically buy some building blocks for your applications without having to mess with OSs or virtualization or what you have in the data center. So you don't install a database server, for instance, you just rent yourself a database. And you don't install a web server, you just rent yourself a web server where you can host your application, and the cloud provider is providing all maintenance on these services. So you basically are no more than a user of that platform that they have on offer. The last step, and one of the great examples of that, is Salesforce, obviously, which is running this concept, I believe, since 2006 also, where everything is rented from this software developer. So in the case of Salesforce, you just rent their platform and you can configure that platform in order to service your needs and you just use it. You can customize it, you can develop your own stuff in it, but the core application is just rented and you just use it and have no headaches whatsoever around any of the technical stuff that's below it. Because that's, in this case, the problem of Salesforce. This led to quite a few changes in the architectures, as far as we knew in the on-premise situation. So in the on-premise situation, we worked in silos. We had applications, they all had their own database or storage mechanism or what you have. And it was basically all divided in these stacks of the separate applications that your company used. Scalability, you had to take care of yourself. So in the on-premise environment, it was usually scale up, which means that you needed to buy a bigger machine, and which meant you needed to license more cores, for instance, to run this software for more people. And you couldn't scale up, scale down, because all these contracts are on a yearly basis. So if you needed like the first tills of the trenches, like 8 weeks a year, full capacity, the rest of the year, your database server is running at 5% load, which meant it has like 30 cores too much. And a single core in SQL Server costs €4,000 a year. So that adds up quite quickly. High availability and disaster recovery was also something we had to take into account in those architectures. And typically you did that yourself by means of clustering or high availability groups or what you have. And basically it meant that all hardware should be double, because you could never be sure that piece of hardware was never malfunctioning during its lifetime. In fact, hardware works until it stops working. So you needed to have everything double to prevent your site or your application from going down. And it was hardware dependent or hardware bound. You have a hard ceiling. And that hard ceiling is very well measurable. And you knew up front that over a certain load, you can't handle it anymore. And what I forgot to mention, in the silo world or in all these separate application stacks, you need to share data for your management information across those silos, which led to, quite hefty BI projects where you need to gather data from all over the place and combine that in a coherent picture. In the move to cloud, and basically we're still in the middle of this transition, things are way more central. So as it comes to data in the architectures we create right now, we foresee a single data pool or a common data model where all applications work upon. Common data model is actually a trademark of Microsoft, SAP, and Adobe, which has standard entities for most businesses. And their applications can use this common data model. And it's very easy to write your own applications that make use of this particular common data model as well. So instead of working on all these different data sources, you work on a single data source, which makes the whole BI picture a lot easier, and which makes data analysis in general a lot easier, because those applications are aware of each other's data. And yeah, you can react a far more easier and in a far more quicker manner. Scale out. And the most cloud platforms offer this scale out as part of their service. So if we take Azure Functions or Functions as a Service, if you call it once, that's no problem, obviously. But if you call it a million times a second, it's still no problem, because it's running on the hardware of the cloud provider, and they're able to scale out that particular function as much as you would like. So I have never seen the Azure Functions hit a ceiling. That is never the bottleneck. And you pay per execute. So if you are on a cycle and you only have a full load for a couple of weeks a year, you pay for that couple of years or weeks a year. You don't pay for the hardware necessary to support this peak. And most of them also support automatic scale back. So once the load is over, the cloud provider will notice that, and it will scale back the resources needed. In their marketing brochures, they often tell you that their hardware stack is without limits. Well, that's not entirely true. It does have limits. So it's also in their interest to scale you back as fast as possible, but within safe margins, so they don't scale back everything and then the next load comes up. Processes have changed quite dramatically as well. Over the last year, DevOps has become a centerpiece in most development projects. And not only development projects, but basically in the way we work with software, whether that's a SaaS application or whether that's a custom built application. So in the old days, we had this dev test, UAT, and prod environments within a company. And basically every update you did went through those three stages before it ended up in production. Quite complicated to do so. Releases have always been a problem. And I think every one of us has their own stories about, releases that led to many other problems which weren't intended or foreseen. Very difficult to load test, because obviously your UAT environment is not of the same capacities that the production environment had. And we used to do some extrapolating back then, but that doesn't tell you the whole picture. And it's highly inflexible. And aside from being inflexible, it's hard to manage as well. I have yet to see a customer where all four environments are on the same patch level, or have the same build numbers for their supporting products, like databases or web servers or whatever you need there. It's very hard to keep track on that, and it leads to bugs or other problems once you are in production, which is usually running on older build numbers because you don't have as much time to upgrade it as on the rest of the environments. In cloud, we usually work with automated flows. So basically what you see in the picture is a typical branching strategy that we use in order to release software. And again, it doesn't matter whether that's your custom developed software or whether that's a configuration change on a SaaS software. And you deploy it without anybody interfering. And it just goes through the steps of the development cycle to the release branch to the master branch. And if you have a bug in your master branch, which is basically your production, you do create a hotfix branch where you fix this issue and push it back to master. Why is it possible? Well, first of all, the concept infrastructure as code. So we can roll out just about anything that is on offer on Azure without having to create that manually or configure that manually. That can all be done in code, and that can be stored in your DevOps platform and be executed as an extra step in your deployment process. We don't need to keep DTA running all the time. So why have a development environment when there's no development going on? Or why have a test environment when that's only used for like 2 hours during the night and after that, nobody is on it? And UAT, typically UAT is used in a user exception test, obviously, and that's used at the end of a development cycle. So you might need that, I don't know, 5-6 weeks a year or something. And for the rest of the time, it's just sitting there and doing nothing. So we can deploy those in automatic steps nowadays and have those environments when we need them and clean them out when we don't need them. And realistic testing without cost penalty. So in the on-premise situation, like I said earlier, the specs of your test environment are typically half of the specs of the production environment, or even less. So when we do a load test over there, we get a figure, we get the ceiling of the test environment, but that doesn't say anything about the production environment. And in cloud, it's way easier to test that in realistic proportions. So we do know what the hard ceiling is up front, and we can set proper alerts in our monitoring if we reach boundaries or something. A disclaimer. Poorly architected software will remain just that in the cloud. There's a lot of software, and especially the legacy applications that have many releases behind them. Well, it will remain poorly architected software in the cloud as well. It's not a magic thing that everything you put in the cloud, you just throw extra resources at it and it will start to perform, or it will start behave correctly. Unfortunately, that's not the case. So considering that, there's probably some refactoring needed at least. Poorly performing software, exactly the same. If software doesn't perform, we already knew that in the old days, throwing hardware at performance problems doesn't solve a thing usually. It will just, well, basically, it doesn't help. I've seen customers buy huge amounts of hardware just finding out that it didn't help because they had a locking and blocking issue, for instance, which isn't hardware related. Untested software is obviously untested software. Testing software became very important over the last few years to the point that we don't want to release software that wasn't tested. And one side of testing is functionality. So a piece of software should do what it needs to do and nothing else. And load testing is obviously there to determine the capacity or the ceiling of the amount of traffic that you can handle with your application. And like I stated earlier, extrapolated load tests, they are sleeping pills. They give you an indication and you might think that it's all right. But nowadays software is made up out of various components. And some of these components scale very nicely, and others, like a relational database, for instance, they don't scale nicely. So if you don't do it in the proper dimensions, you don't know what it's going to do in production. Then over to the people side, because that's also a thing. And I see, I'm no psychologist by any means, but I see a lot of problems at different customers where people are not always too eager to go to the cloud, or they're more or less unsecure what the cloud will bring them. So there's two sides to that. The reskilling and upskilling, obviously, and the will to embark on a career-long learning path, because if you did follow the technical innovations over the last few years, the pace is picking up and it's still picking up. So there's every month a new hot product that everybody wants to use. And well, sometimes we do, but then you have to learn that. If you look at a typical setup of a business, a couple of years ago, maybe 10 years ago, everybody was running in their data centers, and they employed a lot of people to keep that up and running. So we had for networking, we had system engineers, network engineers. We had all those SANs sitting around there, which were managed by storage engineers. VMware was already there and Hyper-V. So we needed a virtualization engineer for that. And then we had the people that managed the operating system. So again, system engineers, identity engineers, directory specialists. And there's a bunch of other roles which I left out for brevity. We had the data guys, which were basically the DBAs managing the relational databases, and BI developers and data analysts. And on the application side, we had developers. Below that, there was a structure of architects, which you can still find these days. So we had an enterprise architect responsible for the overall picture of the whole environment. Then we had infrastructure architects who just occupied themselves with the infrastructure, and BI architects, obviously, and solution architects for applications. If we move over to infrastructure as a service, a couple of roles disappear. Virtualization engineers, that's provided by the cloud platform. Storage engineers, that's also provided by the cloud platform. And networking is can go both ways. There's still a lot of networking that you have to do yourself in Azure or in AWS, but it's a lot less work than configure and patch all the switches that you used to have in a company. So that's typically taken over by a cloud engineer. The rest doesn't change, because if you run infrastructure as a service, you just get yourself a bunch of VMs in the cloud. Is this a viable way to go? Well, in my opinion, it isn't a viable way to go to the cloud. This can be done in a traditional hosting provider as well, and probably cheaper. If we move one step beyond and go platform as a service, even more roles disappear. Well, in this case, especially the DBA, because you rent yourself a database. You don't have the concept of a database server with all the security stuff and all the management stuff and backup and high availability and all that. That's taken away. So the DBA, yeah, more or less is out of a job in this space. Cloud engineer also occupies themselves with OS if there is a concept of OS in some platform as a service offerings. There still is a concept of an OS which you can configure things, but usually there isn't. The infrastructure architect becomes a cloud architect, obviously, because the basic layer of infrastructure he was working on is now provided by your cloud provider. The last one is software as a service, where you basically only need the developers and the data guys, the BI developers, the analysts, the engineers, and the scientists. For the rest, it's all provided for by the offering itself. So you don't need to do any technical stuff aside from hooking the thing up into your own net, into your own domain. And that's about it. So that's, again, a lot less work for all these people that were on the payroll a couple of years ago when we were all still in the data centers. And software as a service, a solution architect, again, you can question that, because there's a lot of platforms or software as a service offerings that do provide a lot of configuration options and a lot of custom development options. So whether or not that one is gone, that depends. The infrastructure architect is gone, obviously, because you don't need to do anything on that part. There's one question. How about data architect? That's a fairly new role. That wasn't there in like 10 years ago. Data architects develop data solutions, obviously. It's one of the roles that we do. Data architects are there to make sense out of the whole sea of data that the typical company is accumulating over the years. So those techniques, especially in the cloud, give you far more options than you actually could do in an on-premise situation. So if you wanted to do that in an on-premise situation, the amount of hardware you need for that is staggering. You could do it, obviously, but it was not very very common to do that. In the cloud, it's far easier, and there's a lot of tools available that you can use and that you can use fairly simply, and where you have a proper time projection for the end of such a project, and also for your analysis, by the way, because in the early days it was only done by telecom providers and big banks, and we ran reports that ran for like 2 months, which isn't very handy. That's the area where the data engineer and data scientists are working on, and data architect, yeah, it's not on the list, but it should be there. Reskill path. One of the first things we could think of in an IT team that's made up of all the roles is to reskill those people to new functions. And there's a couple of logical reskill paths, obviously. A system engineer to cloud engineer. He knows all the terminology. His legacy knowledge is not wasted in this case. And the same goes for a network engineer. They still have very valuable knowledge, which a junior won't have. Simply because they are there, they have more experience, they know obviously the business that you are running, and they can be easily transformed into a cloud engineer. For a storage engineer managing the good old SANs, there is no clear path, because storage is one of the keys of any cloud platform, and it's so cheap and it's so easy to use, there's nothing to manage there. So, well, depending on his or her interest, he could go to some other role. Obviously, storage engineers are also highly qualified technical people that should have no problems to reskill themselves in any other path that is still necessary. Virtualization engineers, nowadays, they usually go to containers and manage container setups, but virtualization engineers, that function already disappeared in a lot of companies because they handed that over to the data center provider. But let's say you used to have like 4 virtualization engineers managing your VMware infrastructure, then you need only one of them as a container specialist, because that's far less work. Identity and directory specialists, cloud security or cloud engineering, and a DBA typically goes to data engineering. And data engineering is a fairly new role. It came up around 2015. And data engineer is more about gathering data and get it in a proper format so analysts and data scientists can work with it. So you have like, let's say 20 sources within your company. And you also use some external sources. Maybe Google Analytics or something on your website, or I don't know, some open weather data about climate. That's a job of the data engineer to gather all this, put it in a proper format where everybody can make use of it and analyze it. This is only the technical stuff. The transition of people is way harder. Right now, I'm engaged on a project where we go from a waterfall method of developing software over to a Scrum way of working. And we get a huge pushback from the people that have worked for ages in a waterfall method. And that's, don't get me wrong, there's nothing wrong with waterfall, but it's just not appropriate for the projects we are doing right now. Those projects are agile. The software is agile in it. We need to have an agile way of working, and we need to deploy that not 4 times a year, but maybe 20 times a year. And people give us a lot of pushback just because they are either unfamiliar with the new way of work and feel very insecure about that, or just want to stick to the old way of working because that always worked, is then their argument. So this one is a very famous a transition model from William Bridge, who did some investigation into that. And he identified three zones, the ending, so the environment you are going to leave, the neutral zone, when they are in between those areas and still look back on the good old days, but also start to look forward to the new beginnings. And I'm currently engaged on this project for like half a year, and only now people start to see the advantages of work in a DevOps way or in a Scrum way. And they are now actually participating into the process to move over to the new situation. And that's not the first time I've seen this. When we go back a few slides and see, for instance, the position of the network engineer or the system engineers, 10 years ago, they would be the go-to guys in any company because they could fix anything. Whether you had a problem with a file for which you were not registered or other security related stuff, they could help you, and they could help you on the spot. So their position changes within a company. They lose their stature, and they obviously don't like that always. So they give you a lot of pushback in this move to the cloud until they see new possibilities and also from their own perspective. And it takes a lot of time and it takes a lot of talking, and it might seem lost time, but in the end, it isn't that bad, because hiring a complete new staff, or basically the American model, you could do that as well, but that's even more expensive to do so, because you hire a whole new team who doesn't know your business, which sets you back even further. So although people might react not in a way that you would expect them to do, and it's not related to age, by the way. I've seen people from, let's say, in the end of their work life, react very enthusiastically from a move to the cloud or to Scrum or DevOps or whatever. And I've seen people in their 20s react very angry on the same move, all within the same company. And the way to deal with it for me is always to have a very clear roadmap. Where are we now? How are we going to finish things in the on-premise situation? And how and when do we plan to move to the cloud, to a new environment? And what's your role in it? So if you are now responsible for the network infrastructure, what are you going to do in the new situation, and how are we going to get you there? So there's a lot of individual work with employees to get them from A to B, and a lot of schooling and a lot of experimentation in the neutral zone to get them confident enough to see the advantages and to move over to a new beginning. that was the end of my presentation. I would like to thank you all for your attention. And well, if there are any questions, I would love to hear them.
There's one question in the Q&A coming from Peter Zertam asking, how did you approach this transition on a human level?
Yeah, like I just said, you have to really make a roadmap and show the people, where are we now? What's your role in this now? And in the new situation, where are we going to? And what's your role in that setup? So you can't expect people to go along with this whole cloud wave without knowing for themselves where they are positioned in the team in the new situation, because they know themselves as well that they are working on legacy technology and they could be worried that they are not even there after a while. Well, that is the starting point. And from there on, people need to get confident in the new environment before they really start to take their responsibilities there. And if they don't have that confidence, you need to give it to them by means of training or reskilling or just doing stuff with them until they have this confidence in themselves.
So basically, in summary, it's people who've worked on legacy, it's important for them to know that from day one, going to the cloud, that there is a plan for them to go along, so that along the way, there will be less resistance when people know that they're included in the future plan.
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay, there's another question from René Visser. Could you elaborate on how you guided the teams toward new application architecture to fully get the value out of cloud?
Yes, that's just... Basically, the typical assignment for us starts when they are in pain, and or we were there while they were in pain and come back a couple of years later or sometime later. And we always use that pain period to show them the value of what cloud could do. And we always ask them, so where is your pain? What goes wrong here on a monthly basis or on a weekly basis? There's always weak spots in an application. By the way, in the cloud, that's no different. And based on that information, we try to show them what the value of cloud could be in those hairy situations where they, I know administrators that on a weekly basis work throughout the night to keep everything up and running. And that's a, well, a fairly extreme example, but to show them how that could be in the cloud and how you could monitor stuff in the cloud, or if you need extra capacity, you spin it up in a couple of minutes and you're running again. So that's usually how we talk to the technical team about the advantages of the cloud. And obviously there's a world of other possibilities. And sometimes that's usual to bring on the table, but sometimes that's not even relevant. Not everybody is interested in the latest and greatest tools on data science or something. They just want to have it run on a stable basis.
Yeah, so basically it's when you show people that this can make their lives easier or better.
Exactly.
Yeah, okay. So another question about the picture where you showed a move from private to hybrid and to public cloud. How do you see the privacy aspect?
Yeah, privacy is a big thing, especially when you go to public cloud. Obviously, there's a lot of countermeasures that you can put in place to protect your data or to protect the data of your customers, because that's the most important data that you need to protect. And there's a lot of architectural decisions that you can make in order to provide the maximum protection on this data. That always comes with a cost. So generally speaking, the whole public cloud idea is to trust your cloud provider, which nobody does, by the way. And on top of that, there's a bunch of things you can do which will make your life harder and which will make the end solution harder, but which provide a higher security level and a higher protection level. So that's always something we discuss. We primarily work with data, which is at the moment the most prized asset most companies have. So they want to take very good care of that, and they don't want their company name all spread out across the newspaper because they lost a lot of data. So we always provide various scenarios that we can do, and some of them, most of them make your life harder, but make managers sleep better. And it's up to the customer what kind of protection and what level of protection they want.
Is it then a different level of protection or skill set required from the team as well? Is that something they need to evolve in?
Yes, and it's totally different anyway. We always start a discussion with the remark, what makes you think that your data center is more secure than the cloud? The cloud providers, Google, AWS, and Microsoft, all three of them, they know what's going on in the world, and they keep a very tight eye on their basic infrastructure. And they can actually spot whether you are under attack, and they see data movement that's out of the order and access patterns that are out of the normal order. And they actually warn you for that. So for that, it's life has become easier, but the old skills are still valid. Do I encrypt my data or don't I do that? What do I encrypt? Do I encrypt everything or do I encrypt, some salary fields or something, or address fields? And what are the implications of that? Those skills are still valid.
How easy is it for someone who, I'll say, used to be a traditional security engineer to move across to become a cloud security specialist?
That's fairly easy, yes. And I don't think there are security specialists at the moment that don't have a notion of cloud. Most of them are already in that particular area of work.
Okay, clear. There's another question. It's quite a broad one. So you try to summarize it. What would be the best step to migrate a complex data warehouse from on-premise to the cloud?
That's actually one of my newest assignments to do this particular one. Again, it depends. So what's the platform that it's running on right now? Is that a compatible platform? Let's say we're using SQL Server right now for our data vault model, and let's move that into the cloud. Well, that's a project of a week. If we are talking about some other platform, let's say you want to move from Oracle to Synapse, then it's a lot harder. But in the end, there's a ton of options in the cloud. So are we still going to use a relational database, for instance, or are we putting everything in a common data model just on a data lake and do our analysis from there with the tools that are specific to that particular job? So what the cloud did in the data field is decouple the storage from the processing engine. So we have a bunch of data, the tables and the rows in it, obviously. We could dump them on a data lake and plug in Synapse when needed. And if you want to do some very sophisticated machine learning algorithm, we plug in Databricks and use that very same storage where an hour ago Synapse was still working on it. So we have we are very flexible in the cloud, and we can do a lot of things, but it's, I would say, just about, you can do all those migrations, but the question is, how much innovation do you want in that project? Do you want to put it over as is, or do you want to do some extra stuff with it that wasn't possible at the moment?
And then there's one more question. Is the transition of roles was made very clear in your sheet, and it's easier, I think, when you have separate persons for each role. How can you make a successful transition if you have a very small team and if people are responsible for multiple roles? Is that also doable in a cloud environment, or do you need more specialists?
Again, the question is, are you in a hurry or not? So I showed you a couple of flavors of the cloud. So the infrastructure as a service and the platform as a service, and in the end, the software as a service. Are you going from A to Z in one go? Then you have to hire some additional specialists possibly. Or do you take your time and move over gradually in a pace where your team can keep up with the current developments? Because there's a lot of companies, obviously, that run in a small team, and that, well, sometimes it's only four or five guys that run the entire shop. And you need to run the shop, and you need to get accustomed to your new environment. So then the pace would be a little bit slower, I suppose.
But it's not, you don't necessarily need, I think that's the main crux of the question, is you necessarily need a much bigger team when you go to the cloud?
No, the whole essence of the cloud is less administration. So the whole trend in the industry is that you actually go down on the amount of people you need for a particular environment. If we take the example of a DBA in the old days was responsible for 30 to 40 databases. When we look at an Azure Cloud DBA who runs SQL Server DBs, I think it's up to a couple of hundred DBs per DBA. So that's the whole aim of the cloud, to make the life of the customer easier and to not delve into all the nitty-gritty parts of the infrastructure and high availability and backups and all that stuff, but to be just occupied with running your business.
There you go. And there's one more question. We'll make this the last one at 1 minute two. Other questions can be sent through via email, and we will, of course, follow up as well. If you can send your IT staff to one security training, and one security training only, Menzo, regarding data and privacy, which one would you recommend?
Oh, I find it's a very hard question. There's a lot of aspects to data and privacy. Now, I couldn't answer this with, there's not a final security training, unfortunately, for all these aspects of your data and privacy requirements. No, nothing, there are some basic ones, obviously, but they teach you the fundamentals of the data and privacy stuff. And the advanced ones need to be tailored to your specific business scenario.
Yeah, so I think the crux of that is, it's a very good question, because there isn't just one go-to solution in the market. And that if you have a provider who provides you these sort of workshops or webinars, always make sure that it might cost a little bit more, but that it is tailored to your organization specifically.
And it's one of the fastest changing subjects in the business.
Yeah. There we go. Well, thank you all very much. Thank you, Menzo. Definitely. Thank you all for attending. If there are any questions, you can always reach me, and we will also reach out to you. And there will be a live recording of this webinar for those who couldn't attend, or for those who would like to see it again. Once more, thank you all, and have a great day.